You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to... Oh, that sounds awful already. Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. No, I've not been abducted and replaced. I have just got a cold because I have a near two-year-old and he just transfers every germ imaginable to this house. And this is where I am now. But I am joined on this episode with something a little bit different. This is why I didn't want to cancel it. I thought, no, we're doing this episode. It's going to happen, even though I sound awful. I'm joined by referee extraordinaire from over the border. It's Sandy Beeches. Welcome to the show.
Extraordinaire. That's a high praise.
And that's what we do here. We're full of positivity, even the negativity of me sounding like I've got like a cheese grater in my throat and tech issues. I had a nice webcam and everything. Previous episodes have been HD and everything. That broke yesterday. So it's just a comedy of errors. Here we are, though. But we're gonna speak about refereeing. We're gonna speak about wrestling. That's always a good thing to do to make everything all the more better. But yeah, how's it going?
Very good. Yeah, thank you. Been trying to keep busy. Had like a nice few weeks of a break of refereeing. I've had maid of honor duties and hen party duties to attend to. Living life.
So you guys take that a couple of weeks off just in case of the bumps. You don't want to end up at a hen party or anything with a black eye and a dislocated shoulder from all the counting.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, to be honest, a black eye might have been quite good for my costume because we had a Shrek themed hen party, and we all dressed up as characters from Shrek, and I was the magic mirror on the wall. So I literally have this ginormous cardboard frame around me, and my head stuck through like a cut-out black turtleneck, and I had my face all painted white and then with black eyes. It was interesting because we went to an event where literally no one else was in fancy dress. That was an interesting night. It was a lot of fun, though.
That's commitment, because it was one of those things where you got the costume together and thought, oh no, I may have overcommitted here for trying to get through doorways and
yeah. Head. So I had this kind of like crazy idea because we ended up having this like really big cardboard box and I was like, what can I do with it? And I kind of went for like, I was like, oh, maybe I'll be like Gingerbread Man because like, you know, I'm ginger, but that sounds a little bit boring. You know what? I'm going to be really niche and we're going to go for the mirror on the wall. So I ended up getting really like obsessed with it being perfect. Oh, hello, I've got a cat here now. It's another cat. So yeah, I ended up getting like crazy perfectionist with this costume. And then by the time we kind of got there and everyone was dressed really lovely. Like we had like three blind mice, we had like the fairy godmother, and then we had Princess Fiona, who was the bride, but she looked really nice to say that she was an ogre. And then there was me with this ginormous cardboard thing around my head. And I was like, oh, I actually look like something from the Mighty Boosh right now.
I like, it doesn't matter how old we get. If we see a box, we're just like, we need to do something with that box.
I do with the box.
Yeah, what are we going to do with the box? I remember tangent straight away. Remember when I was younger, we had a massive cardboard box. It was Halloween or something. And I might age myself really terribly here, but there was the villain in Action Man was Gangrene, he was called, and my dad made a whole costume. It was just a big cardboard box, little cardboard box for the head, and then he made the like hair out of more cardboard. It looked incredible. However, when they did the wee fashion show in primary school, you had to go around all the classes and try to get that thing around a class with all these narrow tables. It was By the time I got to like last class, I was pretty much in tears going, I've regretted every choice I've made here. By
I'm like imagining, like, you know, the scene of Mr. Blobby on This Morning. Yes. Where I just knocked everything over.
That's what it felt like, all these kids having to try and get their chair back in so they could, I could get past them and round them with this massive cardboard box. I mean, I could have just wore a black t-shirt and face paint. That would anyway, that's one of the ones.
Enough.
It's one of those memories that you wake up at night going, why did I do that? Why did I think that was a good idea? Even though it was, at this point, probably about 25 years ago. I'm like, no, it's haunting me. God. Whatever.
God. Yeah.
Anyway, wrestling. Now, we should probably speak about that generally, because there's a wrestling podcast. We'll start with the basic, you know, obvious question, the icebreaker, the cliche. What made you a fan of wrestling? What was the moment that you became a fan of professional wrestling?
Well, I didn't have any kind of like family members or friends or anyone that was like into wrestling when I was a kid. I just remember like my dad had all like the Sky Sports channels, and like a weird little task that I set myself when I was a kid was, I'm going to go all the way from the first channel, and I'm going to go all the way up to like the last channel. And then I just remember like stopping when we kind of got to Sky Sports. And I just remember like pyro going off, and there was this like really cool music. Like, I don't remember like kind of the exact match or anything, but I just remember like stopping on it and being like, this is amazing. And then it was literally absolutely like hooked from there. So I kind of started watching wrestling probably when I was around about, I want to say maybe like 8 or 9. So I kind of joined literally kind of just after the sort of WWF phase. But I feel like my kind of childhood was very much like Rey Mysterio, Big Show, Brock Lesnar, and that kind of gang.
As soon as you said you were going up the channels, thank God you finished round about there, about the 400s odds, about halfway through.
No.
It gets a bit dodgy when you get past there. I think you get music challenges before it, but yeah, it's that could have ended much worse. At least
it was very. I stopped at the Sky Sports. We don't want to go past the 900s. You know, my fragile mind could not have had.
Instead, it was men in their pants. Instead, that was the trade-off.
Other pants.
So we're talking about what, 2003, 2004-ish, for getting into it. That was a nice sweet time. It was you had the SmackDown 6. You had all that kind of. It was like good wrestling, and then it gradually got a bit weird around about the late 2010s into the 2010s. But was that your first favorite then? Big Show, Brock Lesnar, Rey Mysterio, just the SmackDown guys?
Definitely like one of my favorites as a kid. I felt with him obviously being like so small, but yet so kind of like athletic. I kind of like, it was very strange that I never really saw like Jeff Hardy, because he was kind of not really sort of like around at that time. It was definitely more like Matt Hardy version one kind of stuff. But I was always kind of a really big fan of him, and because I kind of knew about Matt Hardy, I wanted to kind of find out a little bit more about Jeff Hardy because they seem really cool. So then I kind of like did back sort of research and would watch kind of like, obviously, you know, the Hardy Boys with like Edge and Christian and all that kind of stuff. But we had like terrible internet when I was a child. It was very much the dial tone internet. So my kind of research was very limited going back as a child in terms of seeing wrestling previous to what I could see on TV.
Oh God, the dial up. You could only go on after 6 p.m. because it was free at that point, but only for an hour.
It's literally like feeling like you're paying like a pound for a session, and you hear that tone and you could never unhear that tone.
Absolutely not. I mean, I think, to be honest, it probably wouldn't be the worst thing in the world for it to go back to that, because everything is so readily available that I wouldn't mind being able to just have to wait those couple seconds for the tone to go, and then you want one picture to load, so that's an hour. That's that ran out.
A bit more from ourselves, we might not have just the phrase Google it anymore, because like, you know, it's not worth it.
No. No, I remember trying to load up WWE.com back in those days, and gee, that was like 45 minutes before I found out what happened on SmackDown.
Reveal.
So get into the Hardy Boys. It sounds like you're definitely a SmackDown kid then. From all the ones you've named, it was you're a SmackDown kid. Jeff, I think, was either TNA or Raw at that point. And I'm a big Hardy Boys fan. I don't know if you may or may not be aware of that, but the Hardy Boys seem to always kind of intertwine in people right about my age, because we're not too different in age. We're 5 years apart, but 5 years older. And the Hardys always seem to still be, even probably to this day, they're still like cool to watch.
Yeah.
Cool, yeah. To see.
If you've kind of got that elder emo about you and you're a wrestling fan, it's definitely the Hardy Boys.
I know, Jeff's always the one. Like, I never really had dyed my hair, and it was quite straight laced, but seeing Jeff, it was like, he had the cool hair, he had the cut out of his tights up his arm and all that kind of stuff. It was like, that was always my SmackDown character. If I made a great wrestler in SmackDown games, it was always like Jeff Hardy-esque, even though I would never do that myself. I would never like dress that way, but that was my dream. It was always Jeff Hardy.
Get your own.
So going forward then, so were you always a fan? Was there a drop off point at all? Was there anything that kind of took you away from wrestling?
Yeah, I think kind of like when I kind of maybe left secondary school, I kind of like dropped off with it a little bit and had quite like a few years away from it. I think life just got very busy and hectic around that time for me. So just kind of just not fell out of love with it. I just kind of maybe grew a little bit apart from it. And then I kind of maybe revisited it maybe round about when I was like 21, perhaps. Because for me, I kind of, when I was younger, I never really knew any wrestling existed outside of WWE. Because I just didn't really have access to it. I just thought it was literally just WWE. So then kind of in my early 20s, I saw that there was obviously like a independent scene in the UK. So I used to kind of go to different events there. I think there was an ICW event when they were doing a tour. I went to Sheffield to see them, and I just remember it. I was like, oh my God, this is really cool. Like, I need to get back into this again. Like, why did I stop? And so yeah, I just got back into it from there. I have to say, currently though, I don't really watch that much wrestling. I kind of got really excited, obviously, when AEW came around. I'm like, oh my God, this new exciting promotion, what's it all about? Would watch it quite regularly, but then again, I've kind of just not fallen out of love with it, but I feel like there's so much wrestling content out there that I'm like overwhelmed by choice, that I'm actually quite happy just getting involved in the wrestling that I'm involved in.
I suppose for yourself and for other wrestlers, it's a bit like a busman's holiday, isn't it? It's like you spend all your time involved in training and doing it, and then you come home and go, you know what, I don't need to watch it just now. I've spent last however long practicing and doing these things, that let's have a moment where I don't have to think about wrestling for just a second.
When I started out refereeing, that I'd end up watching like shows twice, because I'd have to like watch it the first time to watch what the ref was doing, because I couldn't switch my mind off from that, and then I had to like watch it again just to actually be able to just enjoy the wrestling show as a fan. So that's obviously very time consuming, and I was like, I can't keep doing this. So I'm very happy to be involved in the wrestling that I'm involved in, and that's okay for me.
Sorry, I don't know if I distracted you with my comically large water bottle that I'm using to soothe the throat. I felt just there was a, I don't know if it's the internet connection or that, but when I brought it out, I felt there was a wee moment of you going, what has he got? What is that? Yes, TikTok. TikTok shop. Anyway, right. So, yeah, so.
How many times do I have a pick?
So I cut all that out. Who's that?
I was say, how many times for a piss before you get to the end of that bottle?
If I get through this episode without dropping it, I think I'll be quite happy because it's quite heavy. I didn't realize how heavy it was until I filled it. I was like, this is a great idea. And then I carry it upstairs. I was like, oh no, this is a bit heavier than I thought it was going to be. Anyway, I get what you mean when it comes to like trying to consume wrestling nowadays. I mean, for myself, I do this and then I try and keep up date with everything going on. By the time that I do all that, I'm like, right, what I'm going to watch on telly? Oh, I can't be bothered to watch wrestling. I'll watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine or just something just that I know, so it just kind of relaxes the brain. And I'm not doing any of the physicality stuff that you guys are doing. So it's just, it's too easy. That's why we need dial up back. That's it. Need dial up back. So you've got an hour 15. That's all you get. Consume as much as you can in that time, and then that's it. You're booted off. So your mum needs to make a phone call.
Need a back.
So that's interesting to say that you got back into wrestling because of the indie scene. Initially, do you remember what your first show was, or do you remember who was on that first show, or who was on it that's not cancelled?
I can't remember what the promotion was called off the top of my head, but I know it's not running anymore. But I remember they ended up having Paul London on the show, and it ended up kind of like going out the fire exit, coming back in. I can't remember exactly who was in the match, but I just remember it was Paul London, and I was like, oh my God, yes, this is amazing. Let's get back into it. Like, I think it was, I won tickets to go, it was like an O2 Academy in Newcastle. And I remember I'd like entered a competition on Facebook and I didn't know I'd won because they sent me a message and it went to like a message request box or something, because obviously we weren't like friends with the O2 Academy. And so I didn't know I'd actually won the tickets until like the night before. And I literally just passed my driving test and I'd got a car. And then it was like, oh, well, it's in Newcastle. Like, I lived in York at the time. And I thought, oh my gosh, I don't know if I can drive all the way to Newcastle. I've only just passed my driving test. And I was like, you know what? I have hardly like won anything in my life. So I just got in the car, drove, had an amazing time. And then I kind of just reignited my love for it, really.
It's almost like it's fate. That you had to do it.
It felt like that, and I'm so glad I went.
Do you remember what year the ICW show was? Just for my own curiosity, I like to see who's on these cards.
I want to say maybe 2016. I feel like that rings a bell.
So Wolfgang, Shaw Samuels.
But... Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Jack Chester, Joe Hendry. That would have been good fun. Kaylee Ree, Kimberly and Viper. That's a cracking wee card that's there. Not a bad one. We see the names on there, Mark Coffey as well, and that's it. I like go back. I mean, my first ever wrestling show was a tribute show, so it's a little bit different to take in and consume. I don't remember any of it other than a fake Mankind. That's literally all I remember from it. But yeah, that is so Trent Seven on there as well. Jeez, oh, that's,
I know, it's a good one to get back into.
who's who in the future of wrestling? Anyway, right. So that's 2016-ish time. You've got back into wrestling. It's reignited your passion for it. Was there any thought at that point that you wanted to be involved any more than just being on one side of the body or watching it?
I don't think so. I mean, for me, kind of like, obviously when I was like a kid, I was like, this is like an exclusively American thing. It doesn't happen in this country. It's like a wild, like crazy dream to kind of think about that. But like, I remember being in school and we had to like draw a picture of what we wanted to be when we were 16. And I drew a picture of me as the women's champion, which is totally achievable at 16. but for me, like in terms of wrestling, like I've got a fused spine. So I had scoliosis as a kid and that was corrected when I was 15. So I don't think in my head I was like, you know, wrestling is not physically possible or safe for me to do. But then I kind of just thought, because that was it, that there wasn't really any other role for me. Like, I don't think I'd make like a good manager or a valet. You know, I don't have that kind of presence about me. I'm not kind of skilled in terms of like a commentator or like a graphic designer. And I kind of never clicked in my head about like doing refereeing, because obviously for me watching as a child, it was always just men, you know, just like just white men in the background. It didn't seem achievable for little me to do it. And I think it was when AEW started back up, or started completely, that I saw obviously there's Aubrey Edwards on the show, and I was like, oh, okay, like a woman can do this, that's cool. And then watching more WWE, you've obviously like got Jess, who's very, very good at what she does, and kind of seeing more women coming around, looking a little bit more into the independent scene. Obviously there's like GCW, there's Scarlett, who's incredible at what she does in terms of the death matches and stuff as well. And I was like, okay, there's like more women popping up in this, like. And I felt like I was very much, it was like post-pandemic. I was kind of getting, I think it was like towards my 30th birthday. And I was like, oh, I just want to do something more exciting. Like, I'll go do my job. I'll come home and then I'll just slob around on the sofa. You know, when people are like, oh, what did you do at the weekend? Oh, not a lot really, you know, just slobbing around, met some friends. I just want to do something more exciting. So then I was like, actually, I'm going to try pursue this. But then in terms of refereeing for wrestling, I was like, I don't understand how you get into that like at all. Like, is it like football where you've got to take like loads of exams to do it? Like, is there specific like training just for like referees? I had literally like no idea. So I literally just got in touch with lots of different like promotions. It was quite difficult because I felt like post-pandemic a lot of places had shut down, so I'd find a few like training schools and promotions. I'm like, oh, maybe I'll get in touch with them. But then I'd like look on like the social medias and they hadn't been active for like a few years, and I was like, oh, okay, maybe they're not around anymore. But I remember it was Danny O'Doherty at Rise that got back in touch with me and was like, yep, I know this great training school like in Sheffield, it's just opened up. If you let them know, you know, I've put you in touch, I'm sure they'll be able to sort something out for you. And then the rest is history, really.
So before we get into that bit, we'll talk about the pandemic just briefly. We don't talk about the whole thing. But it really was a moment in time where people really recalibrated what they wanted to do. Some people did, like, thought maybe it's their last chance of a dream, like yourself, or some thought, right, I've had no social interaction for a long time, even though I don't mind that generally. I probably should set up something so I can speak to humans for a bit, podcast, and things like that. Making bread, that was a fun time. It was a fun month.
Banana bread.
Oh, I love banana bread. My wife makes the best banana bread, so I had no complaints during that phase of the pandemic, because it was like it's one of my five a day. Exactly. I would tell myself. So yeah, it was a weird time, and it's still affecting people now, and to think that without that, and it seems like, not to put a light side onto the pandemic, but once again, it seemed to be one of those kind of things for you, as fate. You get those tickets randomly, winning that competition that you don't usually win competitions. You end up tickets to your first indie show. You went to see that, and then you just had the moment of going, right, I want to go to the show. Dr. Doherty got back in touch with you. It just seems like these moments had to happen for you to do this.
It kind of feels that way, doesn't it? But yeah, I guess you're right in the fact that a lot of people kind of like took the pandemic as a thing to like reevaluate. You kind of like appreciate life a little bit more in that sense. And you're like, okay, let's do something that makes things feel a little bit more worthwhile.
Absolutely. I mean, you get one life. You may as well try make something of it, make the most of it, or something like that. Yeah. But
so is there... toilet pandemic.
Was it Pursuit? Was that who you were put in touch with?
Yeah, Pursuit Pro Wrestling down in Sheffield. So we're literally train with like Liam Slater. He's like the head coach. But I literally just, he was like, yeah, just pop down, we'll see what we can do. And I remember driving down and I couldn't find where it was. And I was literally like walking around, like, oh my gosh, like maybe I'm not supposed to do this. Oh, hello again. And I was like, maybe I'm not supposed to do this. Maybe it's like a sign that, you know, maybe I shouldn't be doing it. I was looking around, ended up at like a Muay Thai gym. And I was just this little like little girl going, excuse me, do you know where the wrestling school is? And this guy's like literally got this like bloody nose looking at me like, wrestling? Nope, no idea. And I was like, okay then. So I'm literally walking around and then I hear this like crashing of a mat. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm close, it's near. And so I literally go through these like shutters and there's obviously like a ring set up. And I feel that the setup for PPW was very, very different when I started compared to what it is now. Like, it's an incredible, like, facility. I've not actually been to the new place yet, but everything was, like, just set up with the lights and the signs, little commentary table. There was, like, literally everything there. But I remember Liam being like, right, let's do some, like, bumps. And I'm like, what's a bump? Having not done any, like, wrestling training at all. So yeah, doing a few like bumps and stuff. And he's like, also, it's like referee training that you want to do, like, you know, let's make you like a great female referee. And I kind of was a bit like, I don't want to be a great female referee, like I just want to be a great referee. And he's like, nope, completely get it, like I get it, yeah, that's cool. And it just, yeah, went from there. So I kind of get involved in the training when they're kind of doing drills and things, but kind of when it gets into more sort of technical sides of wrestling, that's when I kind of step out and then be referee Sandy Beeches. So if they're kind of putting like little sequences together where there's kind of like pin spots in there, that's when I get to jump in. Do a lot of training with Lee Thomas, another referee. We kind of come as like a package deal, it seems, on most shows, which is great. He's so good at what he does. And we kind of just feed off each other's positivity. And it's quite good that we can kind of give each other feedback and not be offended by it, you know. And it's always a lot of fun.
Initially told, because you said your spine and what have you, when you're initially told, when you walked in, right, we're gonna do bumps, and then the walk through, what it was that your first like not even a red flag, but going, no, that's not what I'm here for. I do things at the front, that's
because like I mean in my day-to-day life, like my kind of back doesn't really affect me. I'm not very flexible in terms of side to side, you know. I've got a little bit of a posture of an ironing board, but in terms of that, it doesn't really affect me, so I don't think about it too much. But yeah, when he's like, right, let's do a few bumps, and I was like, I just want to count to three. But yeah, I mean, thank God that I'm kind of trained to bump and things, because I've had to use it a few times in my few years.
I bet. I really like Pursuit just suddenly appeared on my TikTok. I've seemed to be on there. How they got two mentions in this episode, I don't know. But yeah, they're on TikTok, and they just scrolled through and I got to see a little bit of Will Cruz doing a bit bits and pieces and stuff like that. It just looks like a really nice kind of setup, and quite a glitzy setup, I suppose, in comparison to the old dingy warehouse with a couple mats and, you know, all that show posters everywhere. It just looks like really professionally put together.
Yeah. It's a really, really good environment, and kind of like Liam and Nathan have really put something really good together. You know, it's really positive. I feel like kind of from when it first started, people that were kind of on there to start with have really kind of excelled within the indies. Obviously, you've got like Leon Slater, who's doing amazing over at like TNA now. You've kind of got like Joe Wade, who's doing amazing as well. There's like Jet Marshall, you've got like Eve Bateman, like so many different people that are coming up through PPW from kind of like the start, really.
And it's fantastic. See, hopefully by the time this episode goes out, I will have seen Leon Slater for the first time. I'm going to the Discovery show at the end of the month, which we will talk about Discovery, because that's kind of the link we have for, although you mentioned ICW, so we've got two links, Scottish wrestling, that we can tick off as I try to get guests on and go, have you been to Scotland? Maybe, yes. Cool, that's fine. You count. You're in here. That's how I got Mike Mondo. I got Mike Mondo on because he had two matches in Scotland. I was like, you count, in you come. Let's get you on.
Fun. I was like, I've done one show. I feel like a fraud.
Oh, don't you worry. I've done, 200? This is 270. So it's the 70th episode of this podcast, and I still have no idea what I'm doing and feel like that everyone's just kind of amusing me by coming on the show. That imposter syndrome kind of thing, just going, why have you agreed to this? Why? But anyway, we're here. We're still voice.
You definitely, mate. You're doing something right.
Exactly. I don't know how, but anyway. So yeah, you started with first. You've learned to count. You can count to at least three, maybe even five, possibly 10 at times.
Yeah.
What was your kind of? Did you have any initial like things you had to try and get over at first? Was it any like timing? Was there a hurdle that you had to kind of cross over before you felt like you were kind of ready?
I mean, I feel that like I kind of personally don't feel like I'm a very confident person in myself. So kind of getting out in front of like a crowd was very like nerve-wracking for me. I remember the first match of the first training show that I did at Pursuit. And that was Liam Slater and Bryce. And like, I kind of didn't really know the information that I needed to get like before the match to make everything flow and work. And like, I kind of like panicked in a situation where like people are telling me like what their finishes are, but like, it's just like a power bomb, but they'll say, oh yeah, it's like the, I don't know, R2-D2 bomb or something. And I was like, what's one of those? I don't know. Can you just give it to me simple, please? But then with that match, like they'd obviously, like they told me the finish, and there was a point where I think it was Bryce's shoulders were down, and I counted like 1, 2, 3. And I was like, I don't think that was the finish. And then I remember I felt like time stood still because I had Liam looking at me going, was that three? Was that three? And I just kind of remember looking around and was like, yeah. Like, thankfully, it was like in a training show environment. So there wasn't like any heat on me. But I feel like I cut their match short in that moment unintentionally. But yeah, at that moment, I was like, oh, my gosh. Like, I felt like my heart just sink because I was like, oh my God, this is like a show environment. There's like a crowd here. They haven't paid, but there's still a crowd here. And I was like, oh. And that was like my first match that I'd refereed. And I felt the pressure.
if you look back on that match now, though, are you maybe a little bit of a different, a couple of years of difference now? And are you looking back on that going, well, it's their fault. They should have kicked out, kind of thing. Is there a
Yeah, and I guess maybe, well, looking back on it, it was kind of difficult positioning because from what I remember, the pin was quite like close in the corner. So for me, I couldn't be directly like behind the shoulders to have a look at if they were down. But I think I've just learned now that you just have to carry your decisions with confidence and just let it flow. Like, if you get heat from it, you get heat from it. But at least it gives the show a flow.
So go back a little bit to when Liam Slater went, oh, you're going to be the best female referee, and you corrected him by going, no, no, referee. Was when you decided you were going to do that, and you're watching wrestling twice, once as a student and once as a fan, was there any particular referees, I mean, you mentioned Aubrey Edwards, was there any particular referees that you kind of liked watching, particularly for their style, their cadence, or what they did?
I feel like kind of going back, it's obviously like Charles Robinson, absolute classic, one of the best, I feel. And then obviously like looking at Aubrey, I kind of, there's a big difference in their reffing styles. In the fact that obviously with Aubrey, she's much more animated. But then also I kind of feel that you're working within the constraints of AEW officials, i.e. sometimes not really needed or there for what they need to be. But that's just my opinion. But yeah, I really enjoyed like Charles Robinson kind of like back in the day. I really enjoy watching Scarlett Donovan over at GCW. She's very, very good at what she does. But even kind of like within this country, we have so many like amazing referees and so many more that are kind of up and coming as well. So obviously you've kind of got like Lee Thomas that I mentioned, is absolutely incredible. Scott Bell that I work with quite often as well. You've got LK, you've obviously got James Greenwood. And kind of obviously Greenwood is doing his referee training down at Future Shock now. So that's nice that there's kind of like the specific training, and they've got quite a few referees coming out of there. But it's kind of, I feel it's quite important that you kind of develop your own style. Obviously, you know, everyone in terms of refereeing, you know the rules of wrestling, but you can kind of make it a little bit your own. Sometimes I find that maybe I recently watched myself at the latest True Grit show, and I'm like, sometimes I'm just that little bit too animated. Like, sometimes I pop a little bit too much just for a clothesline. Maybe I just need to calm it down a little bit.
It's a personality. I mean, back when we started watching, like I said, I'm not too far in front of you, behind, I don't know. The referees all had names, so all had a little bit of a personality, and then there was a good chunk in the middle where nobody had a name, and that they were just a person in there. But you had your Earl Hebner, you knew who Earl Hebner was, you knew what he was about, your Mike Chioda's, your Jimmy Cornettis, your Tim White's. I can probably list off 10 referees that I remember from my youth, Teddy Long in there as well, even Brian Hebner as well. So there was, you remembered all of them. And then nowadays it's a little bit like that. You remember your Charles Robinson's still there somehow. I would be terrified to, like, if I played, I was going to say rounders because I'm a child, clearly, baseball with him, and he would have a thrown arm, because I bet his thrown arm is ridiculous with all his bat slapping.
He's got one forearm.
Like a Quagmire Family Guy when he discovers the internet. It's just one arm. Nowadays they've got personality again, and you mentioned Jessica Carr, probably one of my favorite referees, because she always carries such authority as a referee. Oh. And it's just amazing to watch.
But yeah, I remember with Jessica as well, recently there was just that spot, wasn't there, in the tag ladder match at WrestleMania, where obviously she's trying to communicate that the ladder is not exactly up to standard, whilst Damian Priest is trying to climb the ladder, and you have that one moment where she's on like the apron, it's just like, oh. But I was like, I know what she's trying to do.
And plus, without Jessica Carr, we wouldn't have got Snoop Dogg punching The Miz at WrestleMania and doing the people's elbow. So without that, without Jessica Carr, we wouldn't have had that. What a moment. Amazing. But yeah, I remember seeing that at WrestleMania, and as soon as I saw her grab the ladder, I was like, ah, I don't, she's pretty much going, get off it. Get off it, yeah. Now. Because yeah. Like, you can see it buckle and terrifying. So you've had your first match, a little bit of a mistake in the count, but you know, that's past it. You're into the next one. Do you remember what your debut was then? Do you remember your first official being an official?
First kind of official kind of paid show was the Northumbria Wrestling Society in Newcastle. I ended up reffing the show by myself. I remember all the matches had at least a 20-minute time limit. And I was like, what? 20 minutes? Like, what? And I remember, I think there was Liam Splater and Spike Trevay. There was Eve Bateman and Gia Adams. There was also like a four-way that involved HT Drake and Big Guns Joe. But yeah, that was like amazing. I remember kind of doing that show, being absolutely terrified, but just trying to roll with it. I remember during Spike and Liam, there was a point where Liam was kind of on the outside. I went out to go check on him, and he kind of gave me a message to give to Spike, and I totally didn't hear it. So I'm like going back to the ring, and I was like, Liam said something, but I don't know what it was. And then Spike's like, what do you mean? I was like, I don't know. So there was just kind of this like confusion coming back in. But I mean, those two are absolute like professionals at what they do. So they managed to style it out. And it was a very, very good match from what I remember. I felt like it was finished by Spike with a hand on the tights to Liam. So I was like, right, okay, I need to make sure I'm focused. I need to be at the shoulders. I can't see the tights like at all. But yeah, from what I remember, the rest of the show went really well. And everyone was very like complimentary of me afterwards. And everyone kind of giving me like messages of support. I remember telling people that I work with that I was kind of doing a debut show. And they were like, wow, that's like, that's amazing. I was like, oh, thank you very much.
I mean, going in a first show and you're doing the whole run and the possibility of 20-minute matches at each go as well, which is terrifying by the sounds of it. And I'm deaf as a post, so the fact that you had to try and do messages as well, I could barely hear the person next to me when I watch wrestling, let alone anything else. So try to do coordinate all that at the same time. That's pretty impressive to do.
Yeah. So you kind of learn as well, because like with me being the only ref on the show at that time, I was like, right, well, I haven't got anyone else to kind of like ask advice on or lean back on. Obviously, like there was Liam that was there, but he had a match, so obviously, you know, his mind is on his match. He can't be like babysitting me the whole time. So I just remember, like, I was like, right, okay, I need to get all these finishes. I didn't even consider that I needed to learn anything else during the match as well, like if there's kind of any like cheating spots that I'm not meant to see or anything like that. And then I've kind of like, as the years have gone along, I've really kind of taught myself, right, if you're going to be doing a show, like just get the first half of the show first, have your interval, and then go on to the second half. But thankfully, the majority of shows that I work on now have at least two refs. You can be really, really spoiled and have shows that have three refs on, which is an absolute treat. But I've kind of learned to kind of understand where to get my spots and bits from to make sure my brain's not overloaded.
Oh, yeah, to streamline it as much as you possibly can. When it comes to match to shows with, if you're doing it with Lee, or if there's a third ref, we say if you're so lucky to have one, is there a bit of a rock paper scissors to choose the matches, or is it a case of if I don't know, there's going to be a big ref bump that maybe Lee's better for it? Is there a kind of a way to choose, or are you just kind of assigned and that's it?
Most of the refs that I work with, we're all kind of really chilled and laid back about, you know, the matches. And not a lot of the times promoters will kind of say, right, I want you to do this match or this match. It's normally quite relaxed that we get to choose. But we kind of try to, if there's any match on the card that we specifically want to do, we're like, oh, I'd really like to do this one. And then we kind of just alternate around there. I know there's some promotions that like me to do the female matches purely because it's like, yeah, up the women, let's get all the women at the same time, which I mean, I understand the reasoning, but sometimes I feel it's not as progressive as they feel it might be. But like in terms of like taking bumps and things, I feel that if a lot of the times we kind of look at bumps and go, right, well, do I need to be like absolutely dead from it? Or am I like making a comeback from this? Because I feel like I can take a smaller bump and still kind of sell it like I'm dead because I'm so small. Like I remember taking a bump at Tidal when it was the previous ownership, and it was Brady Phillips and Will Cruz for the belt, and I ended up having to take a squash from Will Cruz in the corner. And I remember Lee standing next to the previous owner, and his response to me getting squashed in that corner was just, fucking hell. And I just died and crumpled in the corner. But it was a very, very safe bump. You know, Will's an absolute professional to work with. But yeah, so sometimes I'm like, well, I can take a smaller bump and make it look dead, you know, but Lee's very, very good at taking a bump. I think he's taken a few black masses and kicks from Scotty Rourke in previous times.
So speaking of, you said that there's matches that referees kind of, they want. Is there any particular that you kind of fought for that you really wanted to have, not on your CV, but just have as a moment that you're able to stand in the ring with them?
Not that I can think of off the top of my head. I know there was a show that I was kind of working with Lee, and I was doing the timekeeper. It was at SovPro Wrestling, and obviously they had Josh Alexander with the Impact title. And obviously there was Lee Thomas and there was Steve Dean as the refs on that show. Obviously, they both wanted to do it. It's an incredible opportunity to be able to say, yeah, I've refereed an Impact title match. And that just came down to literally like a coin flip. It was like the fairest way to do it. Mm. And then Lee won the flip, so he got the match. And he did a very, very good job of it.
So heavy as the head, is that was Kez Evans?
Yes.
There you go. Nurse Scottish thing ticked off in this episode. Wonderful. So I was noticing some of the matches, like just going through, pretty much I stalked your Instagram for a bit to try and get some notes here, and I was noticing people that you'd be in the ring with, like sort of Sugar Dunkerton, and I'm going to butcher his name, and the Circle, who was in the final of Gladiators, Harley Hudson, who's off to TNA, and Nina Samuels, former NXT UK. So that's pretty big names to be in the ring with anyway, and I'm missing loads because I saw Chris Ridgeway was in the photo and what have you. So are you talking about being maybe too animated for your own good? I suppose that was kind of what you were saying for some matches. Is there a match that you've stood in there and went, oh my god, and you've kind of just been a fan for a split second, maybe too much for your own liking?
I think recently there was Leon Slater against Jordan Oliver. Again, that was at SovPro. And that was kind of just like, this is like such an incredible match that's happening in front of me. It's so fast paced and like bam, 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 bam for everything. But yeah, like I have to be so careful that I stay out the way. Like we ended up having like an amazing big ring for that show. So there was plenty of room to move. But like the way that they absolutely utilized every space of that ring, and obviously like Leon doing his post to post dive, you know. Even utilizing all the outside as well, but yeah, there was kind of like moments where I'm like, I just need to maybe calm down a little bit here. Like I feel like my signature is me just going all the time, and I'm like, why do I do that?
I mean, what was it like being? I mean, talked about SovPro. That's probably a good time just to bring this up. How bad was it at SovPro that they had Les Battersby show up? And then I don't know if this, I think this will have happened by the time this episode goes out properly, but then I'll have Ashley Peacock appear as well. When it comes to being a wrestling fan in general and seeing that kind of weird crossover of I don't even know how to describe it, culture, how do you take that in as both as a professional and as a fan yourself?
I mean, it was a very unique experience. I remember when like it was first announced, like, I'll be really honest, I was like, I just don't get it. Like, why Les Battersby? Like, I'm really confused. But then kind of like seeing him at the show was a very strange experience. And then as soon as like he came out through the curtain, like the pop that he got was absolutely like incredible. Like, everyone was absolutely buzzing for it. And the atmosphere was just amazing. And then even kind of watching, we had like a little backstage live hard cam, and he was kind of watching along, and like his response all the time was, oh, fucking hell, you know, whilst he's got like his can of beer in his hand. And he's like, oh my gosh, like, they're absolutely killing each other. And I think it was like when I was refereeing for Lana Austin and Lucia Lee, he was like, oh my gosh, they're really going for it. And like, you know, he was like so into it as well. So it was quite nice to see. But it's so funny that they're continuing on with the Coronation Street fight. We'll see how that goes.
It's one of those weird, we had a weird period of British wrestling where Mr. Blobby was showing up and all that kind of stuff. And it's just, I'm kind of the same. When I saw it announced, I was like, why is this happening? And then again, saw the reaction, saw the videos up, I was like, well, it's worked. But I still don't understand why it's happened. But and Thatcher Wright's going to be in that match. There you go. There's another Scottish wrestling thing ticked off. Right. So we do have a question about SovPro from Pencils in Nikki, who's fantastic on Twitter and what have you. She does really great work and really enjoys wrestling, which is great to read and see. It's a big question. So I'll just clear the throat a little bit. So she said that you reffed a four-way match at SovPro for the Commonwealth title. I think she thinks it was your first match for SovPro too. And it was such a barn burner. She was in there with Leon Slater, Ninja Mac, Leighton Buzzard, and Man Like Duress. I probably butchered that. I'd love to know what that was like for her. It was such a moment and a fantastic match.
Yeah, like, to say that I had that as my opportunity was my first match at SovPro. I'd done timekeeping for them. I think it was like two shows prior. But then they're like, yeah, we'd like to have you on board for refereeing. It tends to be, if there's like big multi-man matches, because I'm small, I don't take up that much room. So I'm like, I can try and evade all these things. Obviously, you know, we've got Ninja Mac, Leighton Buzzard, Leon Slater, Darius, flipping them all over the place. Absolutely crazy. I was very, very nervous because it was obviously the unveiling of the Commonwealth Championship. So I was like, I can't mess this up. This is like my first match and it's like crowning a new champion and it's the four-way and it's got the import in it. No pressure. But like, it was amazing. Like, I remember kind of Leon doing the 450 off of kind of like every post or whatever, and it was like, yeah, it was an incredible match to be part of, and very, very honored that that I was trusted to do that.
So I mean, that's a huge match to be part of, and we were talking a little bit about earlier about kind of sometimes being thrown into the women's match, you know, just kind of feels like box ticking at that mm-hmm. time. Is that something that you've had often, or have you felt that it's that the promotions you've worked with or the ones that have contacted you for bookings, are they quite open to not kind of see the gender side of things, that you can just referee straight up matches, doesn't matter who's in them kind of thing?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes it kind of pops up, you know, every now and then. I have nothing against kind of refereeing for women. I kind of, you know, a match is a wrestling match, you know, at the end of the day. And there's so many like amazing women on the scene as well. But I feel like, you know, as a referee, like, my gender shouldn't come into it. Like, I'm a ref, I count to three the same way, you know, I don't sprinkle it with estrogen. And so, yeah, there have been some promotions that I've kind of worked with early on, kind of in my reffing career, where I was very, very much put in a box and I exclusively had to do female matches. But I since do not work for that company anymore. because I felt like I made my opinion very, very clear on the matter, shall we say. But, you know, like I said, there's some incredible women wrestling now on the scene. And I love reffing kind of any match. It doesn't matter about gender or anything like that. But there is some times where you feel a little bit boxed. But like I say, wrestling's wrestling to me.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, the last thing you want to feel like it's a promoter just going, hey, look, there's a woman there as well, you know?
We've got all in the building, in the ring, right now.
This is all the women that you'll ever see wrestling fans. This is. Don't know why I started to go after wrestling fans in general there, but we'll move on. So I've got a question about Discovery Wrestling, which was kind of the initial lead in to me getting you onto this podcast. So we better talk about it because we're hitting about an hour and we still haven't spoken about it. And yeah, I'm still speaking. I've still got a voice. I'm amazed. So before we actually talk about going up to Discovery and reffing there, we do have a question from Judas Gray about it. He's asked, are you okay after Ian Skinner threw me into you at disco?
Yeah, I think I'm okay. I think so. I think I've recovered. There was choice words, you know, in the car on the way home. But I think I survived just.
So Discovery Wrestling, that's probably the nicest message I've ever seen Judas send at all. It's usually just absolute filth. But it's not filth. I don't know why I said that. But anyway, yeah, it's Discovery Wrestling then. So across the border, I know you spoke to the guys that work left side. If it was before this match had happened, you'd kind of had the booking and that was it. So coming over to Scotland, usually Discovery has Chris Quinn, past guest of the show, and I think it's Mike Ainsley is the other referee they usually have. What was it like going across the border and working a totally different environment, different kind of crowd, different roster in general? I think most of the people you'd never have encountered before. Or was Skinner just telling you all sorts of lies before you got there just to mess with you?
Yeah, you know, he likes to up the ante, tell me that, I don't know, all sorts of crazy stories, and then you get there, you know, actually, everyone was, like, really lovely. You know, I always kind of get really nervous going to, like, new promotions, and, like, especially, like, with Discovery, like, say, coming all the way up to Scotland for refereeing, was very nervous. But everyone was, like, absolutely lovely. Everyone was very welcoming. You know, I got to do some really, really good matches. So I ended up doing, like, the four-way that was there. So that, I think that was SBX, Ronan King, Talon Jr. and Ravy Davey. I ended up doing, like, a tag match. I think that was Skull Brawl and the Good Times. And then I did two of the tournament matches. So obviously that was Ian Skinner. And Andy Roberts, and then obviously Skinner and Judas, which was a banger of a match, I have to say. I know I'm biased, but it was a banger of a match.
I know, it's a match I hope to put online at some point. Like I said, I'm popping my Discovery Cherry in a couple of weeks, and it's a long time coming, so I'm glad to hear that pretty much anyone who speaks about it always speaks about the shows highly, even like yourself, who's there for the first time, and probably been told that you've got to bribe everyone with tea cakes before they'll do anything for you, you know, all that kind of
they're gonna have a whole match.
So yeah, it sounded like it was cool to see, to be honest, because when it comes to Scotland anyway, I think we have one female referee generally, and that's it everyone else, and that's not for any bad or good reason, but that's just how it seems to have worked out. So when I saw the pictures go up, I was like, who's that? Kind of thing. And I was like, oh, right, okay. I sound really judgmentally going, who's that? Who are you? You're not from here. What are you doing over here? Go back over the wall. But it was cool to see. And I don't know if you received any particular praise do you receive it? Like messages from other women that are like, oh my God, I saw you do this. I want to do that too as well. It gives me the confidence. Do you get that at all?
I mean, not that often, to be fair. Like, I've had quite a few kind of like guys as well kind of messaged just asking like, how do you get into refereeing, like what do you need to do in terms of like training and stuff. So I occasionally kind of get messages from kind of a few different people, you know, kind of regardless of their gender really. But I know as well, LK, she did referee a show for ICW. She made her debut before I did in Scotland. And she did a fabulous job, as she always does. But yeah, it's kind of nice that more women are getting into the refereeing side of things. I think there's, when I see the pictures from James Greenwood's training sessions for the referees, there's always like a sprinkling of women in there as well. So it's nice that it's reaching everyone.
Yeah, it's certainly, especially since the pandemic lifted and everything, like we were talking about, everyone's kind of had that idea of going, right, I'm going to try it at least. And then whether it's male, female or whatever, it's like, no, we're going to at least give it a go. And hopefully there's a generation of referees just waiting in the wings to go. Also, they can wait a little bit longer. You don't want anyone to steal your job. But it's great to see. And yeah, it's just wrestling seems to be in a really good place at the moment. I like to think so anyway. Before we do like the kind of like questions of future, who would you like to ref for, etc., and all that kind of thing, we do have two further questions. The first one is from Ian Skinner, and I apologize in advance because you probably asked this question many times. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games?
I hate it so much, it infuriates me. And he asked me this question as a vegetarian.
Oh, right, okay.
So I go with unlimited games, but no games.
Makes it a little bit easier for you, I suppose, doesn't it?
Exactly, case of information, right?
The other question we've got is from, oh, I'm going to say this, DrillSergeant_soldier on Instagram. Favorite UK hardcore band?
I don't really listen to like a hardcore music, I'm not gonna lie. I am a ska kind of gal. I like a bit of ska punk type beat. So I like The Skints, a bit of Sonic Boom 6, Random Hand, and that kind of thing. Hardcore's not really my bag.
I'm not best placed to try and sway you with any band names as I'm sitting here with a busted t-shirt on. So I've that's my area of expertise. Last three gigs
busted, fabulous band.
Last three gigs I've been to busted, The Script and Westlife. I'm cool.
Westlife. That's only because my godmother's a big fan. So yeah, I think I've got maybe three Westlife concerts under my belt.
It's a cracking show, to be honest. My wife's obsessed with them. She's been to like 20 shows, and I can't judge her because I think I'm gonna hit 100 wrestling shows this year that I've been to, so I can't really go, that's maybe too many, because she turns around and go, how many wrestling shows you've been to, you know. But no, they put on a great show. It was a good time was had by all. Right, so going forward then, I didn't know where that UK hardcore band thing was going to go. I thought it was a thing, but it is not. So we'll
go. Squash.
So going forward then, what's your kind of aspirations as a referee? Is it hitting a particular company? Is it refereeing a particular wrestler? Do you have any kind of bucket list things you want to tick off?
I mean, to be honest, kind of where I'm at with wrestling, like kind of refereeing, I thought kind of when I got into it, I'd go to like a few training sessions and be like, right, okay, that's something that I did. I never kind of expected to be going out on shows, kind of getting paid for it, or actually having quite a few promotions that I'm kind of a regular referee for now. So I'm kind of really, really grateful for the position that I'm at, and I'm so happy to be given the opportunities that I've had. And I think in terms of like goals, you know, obviously there's like promotions that I'd love to work for. I'd really like to referee at North. But they're in very, very safe hands with their referee team. They've kind of got Ross and Katie, who are again, just kind of starting out really, but doing so well, getting out on loads of shows. I think they've kind of explored the Scottish scene as well. I think Katie's been over at Iron Girders. And obviously they've got like Rich Swift, they've got John, you know, a fabulous team of refs, but I would love to work with them. And then in terms of like ICW, obviously that would be amazing to work for. And just, yeah, I mean, even having like an overseas booking would be lovely. I'd love to kind of be able to go on to GCW and work with Scarlett. I feel like that would be like the ultimate goal for me. But I try not to set myself kind of too many goals in the fact that, like I say, I'm so happy with kind of with where I'm at with refereeing. I've kind of surpassed any expectations that I ever had with it. So I'm just really appreciative to be where I'm at with it, to be honest.
Fantastic. Well, I think that's a good time to kind of to wrap up our chat here. We've talked about aspirations and everything in between. We even touched upon Discovery, even though I think we spent most of the time speaking about just anything other than Scotland. But that's fine, because you're very busy. I'm seeing you get death matches and actually, before we wrap up, how do you death match wrestling for you as a referee? How terrifying is it?
Well, I have to say, I've only officially refereed one death match, and that was very recently at my last Rise show. So that was Lou Nixon and Casanova Valentine for the European Death Match Championship. So no pressure, you know. I think I remember I've been on the outside of lots of death matches where Scott Bell has been refereeing in ring, and some of the stuff that you see is just absolutely mind-blowing. And I feel like every kind of death match that I kind of see or am any kind of a part of, I feel like the bar keeps getting higher and higher for all different weapons and such that get involved in them. If you kind of go to like a Rise Games of Death weekend, the setup that kind of like the guys put together is absolutely mental. Absolutely mental. But yeah, when I was kind of doing my first death match, I was shitting myself, not gonna lie. I remember turning up to the venue and Scott came up to me and goes, "Right, Sandy, so I'm gonna give you your first death match tonight." He was like, "It's a class A death match, so it's just barbed wire. You'll be okay." Like, okay, fine. So, like, in that show, I ended up doing my first death match and then my first cage match. And then I also took a pedigree for the first time. So it was a full evening of firsts. But the death match, again, like, it went well. No one got exceptionally hurt in terms of a death match. Although I just remember him being like, "Yeah, it's just going to be barbed wire." And then I remember, I think Casanova went to the outside, went under the ring, pops out this light tube. And I'm like, "Scott, you said it was just going to be barbed wire." But I found like with barbed wire, it's really annoying because it like grabs onto your like sticky weeds and then you can't like get it off here. And then trying to get like the guys out of barbed wire as well. Like a previous show that I've done, we had like a trampoline frame that was just wrapped in barbed wire that B.A. Rose ended up going into. And I remember trying to get him out of this thing. I'm absolutely tiny. I am 5'1½". And there's me trying to, like, reach across this, like, barbed wire trampoline frame, trying to get him out. And I'm like, "There's no matter how much I pull you, you're not coming out of this, okay? I am just coming into this." So we're trying to, like, roll him out of this thing, and he got out eventually. But yeah, it's an adrenaline filled experience to be in a death match, I feel, and that's even just from a referee's point of view. But I mean, in terms of death matches, Scott Bell absolutely like smashes it out the park every time. The last Rise show that we were at, he ended up doing like a death match within a cage, and I was like, how is this possible? You have nowhere to go. And then we also had Aaron, who was the videographer of the show, and he was in the cage, literally kind of like teetering around the ropes trying to film everything. But I mean, he managed to stay out of the way, bless him, you know, hats off to him. He did a really, really good job.
that's absolutely mad. On that note, then, I've probably regretted having this comically large water canister. But where can people find out more about Sandy Beeches?
So I have Instagram, which is Sandy Beeches _. I've got Twitter, which is just Ref Sandy Beeches, double E for Beeches. And that's pretty much it, really. I'm terrible at social media because I have surpassed 30. So I can't really handle that many platforms at once.
That's absolutely fair. But this has been an absolutely wonderful chat. I'm glad that my voice held up for the time that we've spoke as well, because it's been just been great. So I'm hoping we'll see you across the border a bit more in 2024. But in the meantime, yeah, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me.
No problem. Thank you for having me. It's been a lovely chat.